becoming a brand. Business Standard.
Let's begin by paying tribute to our founding fathers who created one of the most brilliant documents of the 20th century, the Constitution of India, and ensured adult franchise for all. We read Session 98, Billionaire Raj, a journey through India's new gilded age. India's explosive economic rise has driven inequality to new extremes. Millions remain trapped in slums and corruption is endemic. Will India become a prosperous democratic giant? Or a saffron-tinged version of Russia? To discuss this further, please welcome James Crabtree in conversation with Suhasini Haidar. This session is supported by Business Standard.
Thank you, and thank God we're sitting down and we have seats, because it seems like this particular hall is packed. I wonder why, James. What are you going to say that could perhaps fill this audience as you have? And thank God James is sitting down, because he's so much taller. It's a little hard. But thanks for joining us. The phrase that stood out in my mind as soon as I had finished the book, the first time I read it, was that even the chandeliers have chandeliers. And we're going to get James to tell us exactly what he was referring to. Of course, this is a room with chandeliers. But it is a quote that sticks in the mind as you read through what I think is a masterly introduction to India's super elite. The book, The Billionaire Raj, begins with a crash, not the stock market crash, as some would think, given the subject of the book, but a car crash in Mumbai. A very famous Aston Martin. The fact that at least the police case, as far as the police case goes, no one knows to date just who was driving that car that night, is, I think, in a way, a metaphor for perhaps how James thinks the Indian economy has been run, is it?
So thank you very much all for coming. The story that Suhasini is talking about at the beginning of the book, the prologue, talks about an Aston Martin crash that happened in downtown Mumbai late one evening, about a year after I arrived, when a sports car owned by one of the businesses of Mukesh Ambani, the richest man in India, sort of totaled itself at 1 o'clock in the morning. And there's a great mystery that remains about who was driving this car and what happened to it. So many of you who are from India will remember what happened. Originally there was a suspicion, who knows whether it's true, that a member of Mr. Ambani's family was driving the car. A couple of days afterwards, a portly elderly driver who was employed by the Ambani family turned himself in at a nearby police station and claimed that he had been taking this car out for a test drive at 1 o'clock in the morning with two support vehicles driving behind him in case he happened to have a crash. Why are you laughing? It's perfectly plausible.
I should add over here that James had assured me before this session that neither of us were going to be sued by the end of it. Continue.
I'm hands up who's being sued by Anil Ambani. Only
if
me.
This was a room full of journalists, there'd be a lot more.
Anyway, this story it stuck in my mind for a long time for two reasons. Firstly, because everybody assumed that somehow the Ambani family had managed to make this scandal go away. And whether or not somebody had been involved in the crash or not, what struck me was that as people in Mumbai gossiped about this, the power of the Ambani family was taken as an almost sociological fact in India. And it's a remarkable thing that, you know, from 1991 through to the boom of the mid-2000s, which is a lot of what my book is about, through to today, all of the changes that have swept across India, throughout that time, the richest person in India has almost always been an Ambani. It's a sort of central fact of modern India, that this family have extraordinary power. And then the second thing was, I actually came to happen across the car. I was doing reporting about the story, and I went to the police station to meet the police officer to try and find out what was going on, and he said, "They're looking into it, sir." And I imagined the car had been taken off to, you know, the wreck of the car had been taken off to be dusted for prints, and then I came out to the police station and found it sitting beneath a plastic sheet outside on the pavement. And I used to go back and check on it every few months and see if it was still there, you know, give it a pat. And it was for about a year and a half afterwards, the sheet getting more and more encrusted with bird shit. And so I just became kind of involved with this story about Mukesh Ambani's Aston Martin and why it had happened and what that told you about the richest man in India.
Was it a metaphor then? Because obviously there is a larger case you make in the book. It's not just about the Ambanis, by the way. There are specific chapters that look at Vijay Mallya, for example, Gautam Adani, Lalit Modi. And then, interestingly, you devote an entire chapter to Arnab Goswami. And I want to come to that. And you devote an entire chapter to Narendra Modi, and I will come to that. But I do want to ask, there is, in your introduction too, you're extremely conscious of the way, for want of a better, less racist term, white people are seen in India, writing about India. What makes Indian tycoons different? Because many would just say, look, there are rich, flashy people in every country around the world. There's that inequality between the rich and poor in even the richest countries of the world. What makes Indian tycoons different?
Well, so take Antilia, the building. So Suhasini mentioned the phrase, even the chandeliers have chandeliers. And that was somebody I talked to who had been a guest at Mukesh Ambani's house. He sadly never invited me. He didn't even invite me to the wedding, which was, I thought very rude of them, given all that I've done for the family, all the publicity I've given them. You'd have thought it would be the least they could do to send me.
You didn't go to the wedding you were invited
no,
to.
No, I've managed to miss out on all of these weddings. I mean, if you think about Antilia, which for those of you who don't know this is the billion-dollar home in Mumbai, the one that is Ambani's house. It's the thing many people who have sort of seen this building. And it's a remarkable thing that even in all of the other cities in the world that are known for extreme differences between rich and poor in, you know, London, Moscow, Beijing, Singapore, where I now live, New York, there isn't a building like Antilia where a residential skyscraper, a vertical palace built by the richest person in the country as a sort of, you know, advertisement to their own wealth. Somebody put it to me that it was almost as if Mukesh Ambani had deliberately built this building to take a city that was already one of the world's most stratified in terms of the gap between the very bottom, where half the people in Mumbai live in slums, and the top. And he had deliberately built this building to add a whole extra layer on top just for him and his family. And I suppose it struck me that that building is a metaphor for the fact that there is something remarkable going on in India. And it is that although there are rich people in most countries of the world, and inequality has been rising in many other countries, including in the United States, that inequality has been rising in India much more quickly and from a much lower base than in those other countries. I mean, depending on how you count it, India has added more wealth at the very pinnacle of its society more quickly, certainly than China did, and probably second only to a country like Russia after its own emergence from closure and sort of socialism. And so India is unusual in the speed in which inequality has grown.
You do make the point about the numbers as well, that in 2006, China had a certain number of billionaires. Tell us about that.
Well, so if you want to compare India, so India in the mid-1990s had only two billionaires, so Ambani and, who was it, Birla, the Birla family, and now it has about 120. So China has many more, but it's a much bigger economy. So the fair thing to do is compare India today to China when its economy was the same size, which was about 2006, and then China only had about 25 or 30 billionaires. So India has many magnitudes more than China when it was at the same size. And so, you know, there's a rather unhelpful intellectual debate in India about, is this a good thing or a bad thing? On the right, you have economists like Jagdish Bhagwati who say, inequality doesn't really matter. The only thing that matters is the rising tide lifting up people at the bottom, which is true. India has a much better better record of poverty alleviation than it's given credit for. And soon enough, there won't be many abjectly poor people left in India on the minimal less than $2 a day benchmark. And then you have people like Amartya Sen who say what matters is the level of the poor, but the gap between rich and poor does matter, and the gap between rich and poor, reasons we can go into, and it's been growing very, very quickly in India, not since 1991 in particular, but really since the mid-2000s, and that's the period that my book begins. That's when India re-engaged with globalization. It's when the money started pouring in. It's when the tycoon class began to go berserk, borrowing money, spending money willy-nilly. All of the problems that India is now left with of bad debt and corporate bankruptcy and political corruption really exploded in the middle of the 2000s. That's sort of when the rot set in. That's when India's Gilded Age began.
All right, but hang on, I do want to come back to this Gilded Age question, because I think you've been asked before about a kind of, you know, sort of almost moralism about people being flashy. You used the term, in fact, you just mentioned it, of building until a purposefully designed to add hierarchy. And it is purposeful. When Dhirubhai Ambani had his AGM, for example, it wasn't an AGM as most people understand it. It was actually in a stadium. Even the wedding that you just referred to, and I mean this very seriously, the wedding was as much about how it played out to an aspirational population, because there were many of these what would seem to be very private family occasions, a puja, that were done on mega scale, Bollywood scale almost, you know, on a lake with massive 100-foot cutouts and an audience that went with it as well. So are India super rich? In fact, picking up on something that others may say is a, you know, clash of culture and something about the old elite not being as showy and actually feeding into a much more aspirational population that's saying, you know, why on earth should we not be flashy?
So I now live in Singapore, home of crazy rich Asians, and so there is a sort of, you know, there's billionaire bling in many, many different countries. I suppose so. It was Ruchir Sharma, the Morgan Stanley investor and author, who came up with the very basic distinction between good billionaires and bad. So I used to work for the Financial Times. I, in a different era, used to work for Tony Blair. Like, I'm not a sort of arch left winger. I'm perfectly comfortable with well-functioning markets and people making money. The problem is that you have a, you know, think of a basic distinction. Some of your billionaires make money by setting up well-run enterprises, competing on world markets and making an absolute killing. That's the story in India of IT and pharmaceuticals, of automotive components. I don't think anyone should really have much of a problem with that, as long as those people pay reasonable amounts in tax and otherwise behave responsibly. The problem is the bad billionaires, and they were the ones I was interested in. They were always much more fun than the good billionaires. I wanted to write a book about the bad guys, and so Vijay Mallya and Mukesh Ambani and Gautam Adani and Naveen Jindal, they were much more colorful and interesting. And these guys are not, you know, they're very skilled businessmen, and they are almost all men. This is not like Russia, where you can simply sustain a business through political connections. But it is clear that in India, over the last generation, many of these business people, you know, got an extra yard of pace because of their proximity to the state. And so that's not the same thing as asking whether the blinginess is a problem. I don't have any particular problem with blinginess, but I think people here should have a problem with the manipulation of politics to the gain of business people. That's the problem to focus on.
The corporate, the crony capitalism, which I would like to come to. In fact, a lot of this criticism doesn't just come from regular people, if you like, but from other billionaires. You quote Ratan Tata saying about Antilla, this is the stuff that revolutions are made of.
Yeah. That's a sort of reasonably good example. The Ratan Tata is the sort of the saintly figure. I often say that, you know, it's a bit like the Beatles and the Rolling Stones, right? That you have the Beatles who are the good guys and then the Rolling Stones are the bad guys. The Rolling Stones are much more interesting, so I wanted to write a book about the Rolling Stones and kind of try and understand who these people were and what made them tick. And I suppose my aim was not to be moralizing. I wasn't particularly interested in writing the kind of book that Arundhati Roy wrote, for instance, which was sharply critical of these people. I wanted to understand, you know, what made them tick? What did they think about themselves? What were they like? What were they worried about? And so the portraits that I tried to write tried to understand the psychology of, you know, why would Mukesh Ambani build a house like this? What was he thinking? Why, when Vijay Mallya, who I met in London over a long afternoon, when he unburdened himself of all the reasons that he'd been so badly treated by India for all of his businesses, you know, what was his thought about himself? That was what interested me, to try and give a kind of fair account of these people. And I think, it's worth reflecting the period that India is in. So the book is called A Journey Through India's New Gilded Age. And we are quite comfortable with the idea of treating Andrew Carnegie or J.P. Morgan or Jay Gould, these figures of the fulcrum of American early capitalism, as titans of industry. And yet in India, you have a range of figures who are comparably interesting and comparably impressive, both in their ambition and the things that they are trying to build, but also often, you know, the strings that they are able to pull, the corners they're able to cut. They're just as interesting, and I found them just as fascinating. If you grew up, as I did, in the United Kingdom and studied in the United States, you don't really have tycoons anymore. You know, you have Richard Branson, maybe, you have Elon Musk, and you have some people who have tycoon-like characteristics. But when I moved to Mumbai with the Financial Times in 2011, I just became captivated by, you know, the tycoon class. What were these people like who sat atop these huge distributed conglomerates, family-run businesses, making decisions over the dinner table, often literally, you know, with their brothers or their uncles or their cousins, trying to work out how to invest, how to fiddle this bank, how to screw over this guy, whatever it might have been. Fascinating figures and of world historical importance and, you know, worth putting in a book. So.
Well, certainly. And I don't want to give away a lot of the book because I think you'll enjoy reading the sketches of each of these businessmen that James has drawn. But there's a lovely bit in there where you more or less ask Vijay Mallya, you know, at what cost all of this has been. And he replies, should I give it away? The Monaco Grand Prix.
Yeah. So I went to visit Mr. Mallya and his he was down to his final six homes in London or in the United Kingdom, down from about 24 dotted around the world. So he was down to one palatial apartment on the edge of Regent's Park, which is where I met him one afternoon. But he also had a mansion in Hertfordshire and a castle in Scotland and a couple of others I forget about. And he was feeling very hard done by, poor guy, because he'd been hounded out of the country. And particularly that weekend, he wanted to go to the Monaco Grand Prix because he was a great fan of Formula One and he still owns a Formula One team, and so he wanted to be there having a party on his yacht, but he can't travel out of the UK in case he's arrested and dragged back to India and put in Tihar jail. So he was feeling very sorry for himself that he had to watch it on television in his mansion in Hertfordshire. So can I tell the golden toilet story?
Please.
This is the story that most people like about the book. So my rule of journalism, my sort of single piece of advice to any of you who are young, aspiring journalists, is always go to the bathroom. Wherever you're interviewing somebody, you excuse yourself and go to the toilet, because it tells you something very interesting about an institution, be it a government department or a company or a private individual, the state in which they keep the most private room in the house. And so 2 hours into my four-hour audience with Mr. Mallya, where he had been drinking heavily and I hadn't, I excused myself on a pretext to go to the bathroom and discovered this toilet decked out entirely in gold, with a golden toilet seat and a golden toilet roll holder and not golden toilet paper, sadly. White towels with golden embossed letters with his own initials, VJM, on them. And so that, I think, told you something about his was another house where the chandeliers had chandeliers, and the sort of the private opulence, and yet also his own set, that, you know, his own sense of kind of melancholy, really, that he had tried in his view, he tried hard to set up a business, to set up Kingfisher Beer and start Kingfisher Airlines. And, you know, he tried to build a successful business. He hadn't succeeded. And now everyone from the media to Mr. Modi to the, you know, we're all picking on him. And so he felt kind of quite sorry for himself. And it was one of the repeat themes that interested me about the Indian super rich, how hard it is to do business in this country. And therefore, while you and I might think that these people see themselves as sort of supermen, tycoons in a sort of Ayn Randian sense, actually they themselves often see themselves as quite circumscribed. You know, they owe debts to literally to banks, but also often to their caste community, to the region that they come from, to the politicians who they have done deals with. And so the sort of sense of being quite constrained was something that I found interesting, and that was true of Mr. Mallya, and it was true of a number of the other tycoons that I met.
It's interesting because Mr. Mallya is known for a throne collection, but of course, the golden toilet was not included in those. But I do want to ask, is the difference then, despite all this money that these people have at their fingertips, is the difference then how much political patronage you get? Because at the end of the day, you do have people like the Ambanis and people like the Adanis that are seen as close to the political establishment of the day. Mr. Modi was seen as an advertisement, a brand figure for the Jio launch. He stepped off an Adani jet when he first came to Delhi as prime minister. Whereas Mr. Mallya is not seen as close to Mr. Modi. So while the other super rich you speak about are actually seen as elements of India's aspiration, you have Mr. Mallya, and as you pointed out, he is reviled. Everything he does, if he has a party, people want to know how he can have a party when he owes everyone so much money, while there are other, you know, super billionaires walking around owing much more.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Vijay Mallya's sort of tragic flaw, in a sense, was that he couldn't help himself being flamboyant. He couldn't help but attract attention to himself because that's how he had built his business. Like Branson, upon whom he modeled himself to some degree, it was his charisma and ability to insert himself into pictures next to swimsuit models, pictures with cricketers, pictures at Formula One that had helped build up a consumer brand which remained, you know, enormously aspirational to a certain kind of young Indian who had been denied the luxuries of international travel and beer and sex. And, you know, he was very successful, but he couldn't stop doing that. And so that meant that he became the focus for both institutional and public anger over the misdeeds that were begun in the middle of the 2000s. And many other of the tycoons who committed much greater crimes, sometimes literally and financially, got off but with far fewer punishments because they were simply quiet about it. They kept their heads down and tried to dig themselves out of the financial mess that they and others had got themselves into. And so in a sense, I not to give Mr. Mallya the benefit of the doubt, but you know, he wasn't the worst offender, and yet he is treated as the worst offender. And that is partially his own fault, but it doesn't mean that there were many others who did worse than him.
Sure, and in fact, you're right about how even the super rich while becoming more conservative in some parts. I have to say, as a Delhi journalist, that term that everyone loves, the Lutyens journalist, the fact is that we have spent many of the last few years discussing the kind of political pressure one comes under. But I'm always told that it is much more difficult to take on India's business classes than it is the political classes, because at the end of the day, the political classes do face an election once every 5 years. Is that true?
Do you mean personally as a journalist? Or
I think as a journalist, to write about them, and as you've pointed out, you've already been hit by a lawsuit. but the truth is that do you think as a business journalist, it is very difficult, and that's what leads to what you spoke about, that sort of, you know, omerta code about a lot of things.
I think it's hard for me to tell. So I speak from a very privileged position, which is one that to some degree I hope I recognize, which is as a foreign correspondent, you know, white Anglo-Saxon foreign correspondent for an elite international publication, whether it's the Wall Street Journal or Bloomberg or the New York Times or the FT in my case, you have a huge number of advantages. In a sense, when Indian tycoons need to speak to their investors, there aren't very many international investors, there aren't very many places that you can do that. And so the institutions, including the one I used to work for, you get phenomenally good access. I mean, one of the reasons I was able to write this book was, with the exception of Mukesh Ambani, who I met only on a few occasions and who always declined to give on-the-record interviews, so I simply had to sort of watch him from a distance as the rest of the courtiers would do when the king would kind of walk into a hotel. Everyone else I got to meet, you know, and would know reasonably well and be able to talk to them. And I'm not sure if that sort of privilege was given to sort of people who work for Indian business newspapers in quite the same way. So I actually found it, compared to doing journalism in East Asia, where I live now, India is a much easier place to do journalism, much more open. You know, Indians like to talk. The Indian tycoons are fairly accessible, and even if they won't talk off on the record, they'll talk off the record, particularly about their competitors. And so I think being a business journalist is actually probably rather easier than being a political journalist if you are a foreigner. And in a sense, that's why I found it and why India is such a delightful place to report from.
Wow, that makes me feel a lot better. Now, apart from the lifestyle, the fact is you spoke about debt right now. You've also touched on that nebulous world of corporate governance and the kind of ownerships that a lot of these families have. Tell me a little bit about your digging into some of these companies, particularly Reliance.
So, I mean, I did various bits of investigative journalism trying to dig into some of these companies. And the Reliance in particular, which is, for those of you who don't know, this is Mukesh Ambani's conglomerate. It makes most of its money in petrochemicals and oil refining. It now has a whacking great mobile telecoms arm that he's just spent an ungodly amount of money building. If you look at your Wi-Fi in this building, it will probably say GeoNet on it, and that's his that's his investment. The company is fantastically opaque. It's a conglomerate sort of hidden within a listed company. If you go in there and try and find out who owns asset. So the Aston Martin, for instance, was owned by a company called Reliance Ports. And so there was a port subsidiary which happened to own a fleet of supercars, you know, which at some level were owned by the family. And I remember spending a number of afternoons digging through kind of corporate reports, trying to find out what the ownership structure was. And you found there was this never-ending loop of shell companies owning other shell companies, owning other shell companies. And it was obviously designed this way. It was designed in order to make it difficult for investors or politicians or anyone else to sort of find out what was really going on inside the company. Now, that is a heritage of a certain kind of Indian business practice, which grew up even before liberalization, in which Indian tycoons would move into whichever area they could. You know, you'd start out in one area, you'd get a license in another. And so this heritage of opaque governance, family control, suspicion of outsiders is not true of many parts of the Indian corporate sector, but it is certainly true of some companies, and Reliance is one. And I suppose I tried to be fair to Mukesh Ambani. I find him an interesting character. I have a sort of sneaking admiration for him, because after the crash, a lot of India's supposedly brave buccaneering tycoons got very scared and stopped investing in anything, whereas Ambani kept going. I mean, he makes extraordinary big bets. He bet the house on this mobile phone company. And in a sense, that's kind of the point of being a tycoon. You know, the point of having this period of early industrialization that India is going through, as America did after the Civil War, is to go helter-skelter for growth, and, you know, build the railways, dig the canals, put the infrastructure in, enable the urbanization, which will allow your country to fast forward on its economic trajectory. And Ambani, he did that. You know, he bet the house on, for whatever reason, on this big mobile phone project. And so I suppose for all of the problems, my basic view is that India needs fewer companies that look like Reliance and more that look like Flipkart or whatever it might be. But nonetheless, there is something admirable about the kind of guts of the man that I came to like.
You've mentioned Jio a few times now and how he's sort of bet the house on it. Is there a larger part of this as well that we have to, when we look into the future of India's economy, we have to think about it being an information economy? The fact is that if Jio does what the competitors fear, many say the competitors are just being losers and weeping as a result of that, and wipe out the competition with a very, very low rate, that that geophones cost, for example. Do you worry that we are looking at super, you know, above this super rich, you're looking at super conglomerates that own not just the medium, but also the information that is put on it, because of course, the same company then owns the television channels and the newspapers as well. As a journalist, does that worry you? Because we see a lot of it in the West as well.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting. Again, if you go back to the American Gilded Age, the analogy between these two periods is clearly imprecise. But nonetheless, you had a lot of things that happened in the American Gilded Age, which give you some hope for the future in India. You know, you had urbanization, you had the middle class taking control of politics, you had the creation of a more aggressive, truth-seeking media, and you had politicians like Theodore Roosevelt who attacked entrenched corporate power. And I think that something of this sort is going to be needed in India eventually. The power that some of these large conglomerates wield is disproportionate. But the case for it has to be made quite carefully, because on traditional competition law grounds, clearly consumers are not losing out because of Reliance Jio. I don't know how many people in the room have a Reliance Jio phone. Like, you guys got free phone calls. It's not as if Mukesh Ambani's ripping you off. He's not a monopoly. He is, in effect, losing money to give you free stuff. And so you need a different kind of justification. In America, there are theorists who are looking at this at the moment in relation to Amazon, which is another example of a company that gives consumers a fantastically good deal, but also wields a kind of suspiciously large amount of power. The movement to question this is sometimes called hipster antitrust, where antitrust lawyers are trying to come up with new rationales why you might take on a company like Amazon, because it clearly is, in some senses, too big and too powerful. And that was the battle that was fought at the end of the 19th century in America, that people began to realize there was something problematic about having companies that big with founders that rich. And I think Mukesh Ambani clearly qualifies as problematic on those grounds.
I think the question, as you pointed out, is what will happen when the competition is wiped out? It's not just about the free phones today, but what about when every hand in the room goes up? When you ask that question, there are broader themes in your book, and it's not just about these personalities and their lifestyles and the kind of corporates they run, but about India itself and how India has changed. You talk about the clash of culture between the old elite and the new elite. You know, some years ago, I remember hearing the Foreign Secretary of India saying that it was an acknowledged fact that India had three mistakes. There was the error of partition, he said, the error of nuclear ambivalence, and interestingly, the error of Nehruvian socialism. When you look at India and you compare it to other countries around the world, do you think, you know, essentially the socialism of the first 50 years was a mistake?
You're tempting me onto very dicey ground here, aren't you? I mean, I think yes. I think it's hard to argue anything other. So I live in Singapore. You look at the lesson of Eastern Asia, countries that were able to industrialize quickly from, you know, being poor agrarian societies through urbanization and onwards and upwards to middle income status to become rich. You know, India lost 40 years by this experiment with socialism, which, although it had admirable qualities intellectually from where it came from and constitutionally, the values that were left by the national liberation movement in India have a lot to recommend them, particularly today. Economically, it was a catastrophe. And I think for all of the problems that have come to India after 1991, almost no one would want to go back to the world that was left behind. And so, yes, I don't think that there's much to say for the system that India struggled along with. I think what it now has is, in a sense, the opposite problem, that it has unleashed a form of capitalism in which, although people at the bottom are relatively doing much better than their parents, and therefore India is avoiding the tragedy that befalls America and Britain, where this generation is doing less well than the last, and that is why there's such a sort of sense of optimism in this country. Nonetheless, it is clear to me that the economic model that India has is one where disproportionately the benefits of growth are accruing to the top 10%, the top 1%, and particularly the top 0.01%. And until you begin to combat that, then that is a real problem, because if it goes on for the next 10 or 15 years as it has gone for the last 10 or 15 years, then India is going to end up in a select and not very admirable group of countries like Brazil and South Africa, you know, that have extraordinarily entrenched levels of wealth inequality. The United States would be another. And it's very difficult to escape from that once you've gone down that route.
The reason why, because obviously as Indians, we tend to think of the country as a unique place. And some would suggest that the success of India, you know, where you say that maybe Nehruvian socialism was a mistake, but some would suggest that the success of India is different because the entire world's values, in a sense, rest on India being a success, not just as a great market with a great GDP, but being all of what you talk about, the inclusive, the pluralistic democracy. And those values are being fought for as well here.
I mean, I agree with that. So when I took the book, came out last year, and I went on book tour in the US, the first thing I always said to an American audience was, you all need to care about India much more than you do. And that's not to say that, you know, people in the US are very worldly about foreign policy, but, you know, they've got China and Syria and all sorts of other things on their mind, the Russians meddling in elections. But in the end, as China heads, you know, fairly firmly in the direction of being a neo-Leninist autocracy, then the world has an enormous stake in the success of India. And in a sense, the success sounds quite modest, which is that were India to succeed, by which I mean that it becomes a firmly middle-income country by the middle of this century and still a multi-party parliamentary democracy defined by the values that are enshrined in its constitution, then that would be a stunningly important success, not just for India, but for the future of mankind, as important as the American Revolution was in its own time. And so in that sense, yes, India is unique. But in another sense, India is entirely normal. And I think this impression that India is unique is problematic. It was useful for me to leave Mumbai and move to Singapore and learn more about the story of Asian economic development and Thailand and Malaysia, South Korea, Taiwan, and begin to see India not as this unique experiment, but as actually just another Asian country which is moving down the path from being poor and agrarian to middle income to eventually being rich. And so, you know, we know the template that works for doing that. You know, East Asia has already done this. And so I think there can be something damaging in assuming that India is always going to be unique, because it means you don't look to other templates of success to see how everyone else has done this before you. So there's a lot to learn as well while appreciating the uniqueness of India's heritage.
Okay, let's get to the Arnab question then. There in this book, The Billionaire Raj, is an entire chapter and conversations with one of India's best known journalists, Arnab Goswami. I have to ask you, what is he doing in the book?
Well, so I didn't just want to write a book about the billionaire rich people. So the book has sort of three themes. One is about inequality and the super rich. One is about crony capitalism and the sort of interaction between politics and government. And one is about industry and India's boom and bust industry. But I was always looking for fantastic characters. I wanted to tell the stories of these amazing people who were remaking India before our eyes. And I didn't just want it to be, you know, core business. I wanted to look at other examples where you saw these themes manifest themselves. So I always knew I wanted to have a chapter on cricket, because cricket, you know, it's a great example of both the power of Indian capitalism, the money that cricket brought into that India brought into the game of cricket, but also the governance problems that came along with it. And I also always wanted a chapter on media. In the American Gilded Age, this was the age of the muckraker press. And as you got into a more advanced stage of capitalism, whether it's in Dickensian London or Gilded Age America, you also saw developments in media that were often a reaction to the corruption you saw of the political and business class. And you saw the same thing in India. Now, today, so for those of you who are not from here, Arnab Goswami is the sort of the Sean Hannity of India. He's a shouty, right-wing journalist with an evening talk show
host. I have a feeling
host.
Arnab would disagree. He might think that Sean Hannity is
the Arnab of America. Yeah, maybe. And so if you have seen, and you go back to your hotel rooms in the evening and turn on the television news, and you'll see 12 people yelling at one another in different boxes, and that's Arnab. And Arnab pioneered this new and slightly regrettable form of very shouty television journalism. But Arnab Goswami began, I mean, he sort of began to make his name partially as an anti-corruption campaigner, partially during the attack of the Taj Hotel 10 years ago, when he sort of expressed and embodied a disgust of the Indian middle classes at what appeared to be the inability of the Indian state to protect itself against these terrorists, but also in 2011, the anti-corruption movements, which defined the end of the last government and propelled partially Narendra Modi to office. And he and some others like him rode that wave of middle class anger at corruption. And so even though today he's a much more problematic figure in his new avatar, there was something fascinating about that moment in Indian media. Sure. And there was something fascinating about him. Again, I got quite good access to him. I knew him reasonably well. And I was always fascinated by the kind of weird difference between his on-screen persona, where he was this hectoring, splenetic, you know, his catchphrase is, "The nation wants to know." The nation deserves an answer. But in person, he was very mild-mannered. He was quiet and thoughtful. He did a sociology master's at Oxford. He claimed to be a liberal, not a conservative. And I suppose as with many of these characters, Mukesh Ambani, Vijay Mallya, you know, the more you dug, the more complicated as people they appeared to be. And so I just became kind of fascinated by Arnab and what he thought he was doing. Did he think that he was he really that cynical that he thought he could bring about this brand of journalism that was clearly destructive to the Indian public realm? Or did he think that he was doing God's work in holding politicians to account and having a kind of robust discussion? And I suppose I remain an admirer of the Indian media. I live in Singapore, and so, you know, I can tell you a thing or two about a sort of slightly toothless and dull, deferential media. And so, although I think amongst this kind of audience, in a Jaipur audience, people are probably pretty unhappy about the changes that someone like Arnab has brought, you know, there remains a case to be made for a shouty, aggressive form of public square, even if he may have taken it a little far.
Sure, and you know, there is a theme in that. You know, the fact, as I said, of Dhirubhai Ambani addressing an AGM in Brabourne Stadium, and Arnab himself being somebody that a lot of an entire generation, if you ask me, of journalists who walked into television probably aspired to be. There's almost a populist theme to a lot of what you put together over there. There's this bit, I'm just curious, what was the answer to that question about why Arnab was doing it, where you quote him saying, "For God's sake, why should we not express our opinion as journalists?" What was the answer?
Yeah, I mean, it was funny. I remember sitting opposite him. I interviewed him a couple of times, and he he doesn't normally do interviews, and he let me come to his television studio, and I sort of sat there watching him do the show a couple of evenings and sort of saw him in operation. And I do remember once asking him this. I sort of wanted to ask him gently, you know, I was sort of gently trying to probe kind of what he thought he was doing. And he always sort of changed the subject. He didn't want to answer this question. I remember once sitting there thinking, you know, should I actually say to him, you know, "Mr. Goswami, the nation deserves an answer." But I never quite had the guts to do it. I don't know. I mean, I genuinely think that he, you know, he thought that by being aggressive and by creating this cacophonous form of debate, that a certain sort of truth would emerge. And I presume it was also, you know, good for him. He was a media personality. He was doing well. He clearly has a bit of a chip on his shoulder about the Lutyens media from which he somehow feels excluded. He grew up in Assam, which is, you know, not a part of India where you get into the elite. And so he sees himself as this, you know, sort of an entrepreneur who had to fight his way into an establishment where journalists and politicians hang around in sort of the center of Delhi and go to each other's houses in Jorbagh. And so he sees himself as this outsider who is not part of a system that he views to be corrupt. Now, that's not necessarily my view, but that's how he sees it. And I think he genuinely does believe, I think he's wrong about this. I mean, I think the form of journalism that he has created is very problematic in a country like India. But I think he believes that, in a sense, this kind of loud, cacophonous form of journalism is a good thing.
Yeah, and certainly confrontational journalism is always a good thing so long as you are taking on the powers that be. You know, you've written a bold book, James. I'll be honest. Every page that I turned, I was interested by some of the things you said out loud, which many would not. But perhaps the most bold thing you wrote was a subheading in your book. because you have an entire chapter.
I'm wondering where we're going with this.
You see, we didn't have this conversation before we came in front of you.
Can I guess?
Yeah, but it's...
Is it India after Modi?
Absolutely right. And it's true. It's an entire chapter about the economy under Prime Minister Narendra Modi. And then there is this phrase in there that catches you that says India after Modi. I mean, are you even beginning to think of that reality?
No, I mean, I think we're already there, right? I mean, I think the era in which Narendra Modi is the predominant political power in India is now over. And we will see that in the next election, even were he to come back as prime minister. So I began this book writing process thinking I was going to write predominantly about business and then some other things that were business related, like cricket. But the more I looked at it, the more I realized that, A, some of the best characters were not business people, they were politicians. Indeed, some of the richest people in India were not business people, they were politicians. And so I wanted to write about Jayalalitha and YSR and, you know, Jagmohan Reddy, some of these incredible political entrepreneurs. And I basically, you know, decided early on that, you know, I couldn't write a book about India that had a, you know, tried to be filled with big ideas without grappling with Modi as an individual, where he had come from, and in a sense what the interaction was between sort of nationalism and capitalism. The success of the BJP under Modi was a function of two different things, one of which was, well, three things: his anti-corruption association, his economic philosophy and the promise of material prosperity and jobs, but the way he merged that with and popularized a form of Hindu nationalism, which until that point had never really been that popular. It had been in power once under a certain avatar, but that was a kind of unique repackaging that he managed to do, and it had extraordinary power. It won an election that almost no one expected anyone to win. When I arrived in India, the notion that not just the kind of Congress party, but Delhi in general was in a form of sociological decline. You could chart a line from Indira Gandhi to Manmohan Singh and downwards, in which all of the big parties were being replaced by political parties that had other identities, caste identities, regional, linguistic. All of the power was seeping away. And this was largely because of the crisis in the Congress party and the crisis of the idea of India that Nehru had begun. But it was also seen to be true of the BJP, and Modi reversed that through an act of individual will and charisma. And between 2013 and probably the last set of state-level elections, he has been the overwhelmingly dominant figure in Indian political life. And I think that moment is now coming to an end. I still think that he will probably come back as prime minister next time, but he clearly is not going to win a majority anywhere close to the one that he had. And the notion that he might lose is now something that people are seriously considering, really for the first time, which, you know, in 2017, after the Uttar Pradesh elections, would have been an extraordinary thing to behold. He still seemed to be this untouchable, anti-gravitational figure, but I think, you know, we now have to contemplate what does a post-Modi politics look like in India. Is it possible to imagine something that is, in a sense, for many in this audience, better, you know, more liberal, returns to a different sort of values, or is it going to be more divided? But I think that post-Modi era is upon us, even if Modi himself returns. So to put that another way, let me put it this way. Liberals have often worried that the problem with Modi is that he will turn himself into an Erdogan or a Duterte, that in a sense India will lose its democratic tradition and someone like Modi will create a kind of autocracy in India. And I always thought that was pretty far-fetched. But I think the problem is much more likely to be the problems that come with a weak Narendra Modi than an excessively strong Narendra Modi.
Well, that's certainly an interesting choice. Very quickly, what do you think that lasting legacy would be, not necessarily today, but 50 years from now? Would the Modi era be remembered more for some of the reforms? Would it be remembered for demonetization?
I mean, I suppose he's going to be, he is a politician of genuine substance. He's remarkable in and of himself as a lower class politician who rose to the highest office in the land. He came from very limited upbringing. He has rejuvenated the Hindu nationalist right in a way that no other politician has been able to do. And, you know, he will have served, I presume, if he comes back as prime minister, you know, he will have served 10 years in office or something akin to that, and that will put him in an elite bracket of Indian prime ministers who, whatever else they might have done, have to be considered very seriously historically. Nonetheless, I think, you know, who can tell what will happen in his second term, but I find it very hard to believe, were he to return as prime minister, that he will suddenly become the radical reforming prime minister that he conspicuously failed to be in his first.
All right. Certainly an interesting point to leave these questions at and take some audience questions as well, just with a quick show of hands. Let's go with the lady right in the front, and then just take a few more.
Hello? One very interesting phenomena about powerful Indian figures, not just from India, from around the region, is once beleaguered in their countries, they seem to find a home in London and in the UK. And this is true of people from the Middle East, from Asia, from India. So what are your thoughts on that? Maybe that could be your next book.
Well, I think it's splendid. Somebody put it to me this way, which was, A, as a man who's being sued by a billionaire, but also having published a book where my publishers were rather worried that they too might get sued by various Indian billionaires. Somebody said, well, don't worry, James. If you really do fall foul of the Indian legal system, then at least you can just live in exile in London like everyone else.
All right, quick, and let's just get some questions.
Okay. You have taken few names of business tycoon in politics, like Jayalalitha, but you have missed out one very famous business tycoon of India, known the first five richest lady of world, Sonia Gandhi, or the Mayawati. Why you are missing out all these business tycoons? Because this is also another way of business in India.
You know what's interesting, I have to say, is, you know, when you prep for a session like this, you always read the other people's reviews about the book. And it is amazing to me how much James has been criticized for both not taking on the UPA government, because he was here for a large part of that, as well as for not taking on the current government enough.
Well, so the gentleman's point is a broader one, which is that there are many politicians in India who people reasonably suspect are, you know, ought to be in the billionaire list. And if you were to have a fully accurate Indian billionaire list, it would be much larger than 120. And so, you know, allegedly the supposition is that the Gandhi family would be part of that list. I mean, in terms of the record of the UPA, I just felt that this was ground that other people had been on before. I mean, the UPA at the end was a fairly squalid operation, and the crony capitalism that I talked about mostly happened under the UPA. So there's plenty of criticism of them in there.
Go ahead. In one of the sessions yesterday, former Chief Election Commissioner S.Y. Qureshi made the point that there are nearly 144 business people elected in the parliament right now, in the Lok Sabha,
sure,
and out of which some 80 odd belong to the single largest party. You made a point earlier about India needing someone like a Theodore Roosevelt. With this kind of numbers going around, I don't think that's going to happen unless the people start believing in themselves more than they believe in some messiah.
Well, you have an interest in this relationship between business and politics. So I really wanted to write about business in Andhra Pradesh. So anyone from Andhra here? So Andhra is the state where this sort of the purest, most triple distilled relationship where, you know, the politicians are all businessmen, the businessmen are all politicians, and you kind of look
and
from one...
And everyone has a TV channel.
You look from one to the other, and you can't tell them apart. They're all on both sides of the deal. And so you have had this phenomenon where politicians in India have started businesses to try and get on in the act. Business people have tried to go into politics. And you see this most clearly in electoral funding, where... India is on course to overtake the United States as the world's most expensive democracy, but all of that money, or almost all of it, as Mr. Qureshi, who appears in the book, notes, I mean, all of it is raised illegally. And so the election this year in 2019 will cost billions and billions of dollars, most of which has been raised from companies under the table. And so that is a big problem if you have that amount of corporate funding of democracy in a way that is not transparent. Yes, you have that level of corporate funding of democracy in America. It's not a good thing there, but at least you know who is funding whom, and you have a sense of what the quid pro quo might be. And it's a problem that India is going to have to grapple with. So.
There are those in government who actually suggest that at least it brings the money back into the system, and people who are putting up the megaphones and the tents are getting it. Sir, your question.
Yeah, James, at what degree do you think that what you wrote about, other than Mr. Ambani, might have been a historical period where these plutocrats had particular impact on a weak central government. Modi, to be fair to him, has reduced the influence of business people in Delhi. But moreover, technology has reduced the barriers to entry to new businessmen. So there'll be more Flipkarts and less Adanis. Is that true?
Well, I hope it's true. In a sense, whether here or in America in the Gilded Age, this is a passing period where the early onset of industrialization does tend to come with many of these problems, crony capitalism being one of them. And Modi, to give him his due, as you say, has put a stop to the very worst of the crony capitalism that was happening around the cabinet table in Delhi, where there was a feeling in 2008, 2009, 2010 that, you know, cabinet ministers and entire departments were in the pockets of particular conglomerates. And it is to Modi's credit that he basically stopped this. But it's not clear to me that at a deeper level, that the sort of quantity of, if you were to look at, I don't know, real estate or particular states in India or the defense industry to give an answer at the moment, that actually many of these places have been substantially cleaned up under Modi. So while he has removed the most egregious examples, I don't think he would go down in history, so far at least, as a sort of staunchly anti-corruption politician. And indeed, obviously, you have demonetization, which was meant to be his greatest weapon against corruption, which turned out to be a debacle. So I think the report card is pretty mixed, really.
So, hello. So what I get to see around the world, politics and economy kind of, you know, go hand in hand and works in tandem. And what you are claiming, like what's happening in India, is kind of like a unique case. Like, you know, it's a steeper thing as compared to other countries. But don't you think like all other countries which could be compared with India, like even the richer counterparts of the world, has kind of like gone through this stage already? Also, the second thing is, if there's a utopic solution to this kind of like this dystopia, so according to you, what the utopic solution?
Well, no, it's a good question, and in a sense, I say the opposite of that. That's why India has reason to be hopeful, because so many other countries have been through exactly this stage. Whether Britain in the 1830s, America in the 1880s, South Korea in 1965. Malaysia, Thailand, they have all been through this stage, and they were all fantastically corrupt. The idea that East Asia became rich on some sort of Singaporean model in which they wiped out corruption and suddenly became an advanced economy is complete nonsense. All of these countries were riven by corruption and paternalism, clientelism. And so in a sense, I was trying to write this book partly to argue that you shouldn't see corruption as a kind of peculiar disease. It is part and parcel of this stage of industrialization. The question is, how do you move beyond it as quickly as you possibly can? And that, I think, is what India is grappling with, not the fact that India's example is peculiar or different from all these other places. What you do about it, I mean, this is a very complicated question, but a lot of it is to do with making sure that you have good governance and that you lose this problem that many in India, particularly on the right, have, that they are suspicious of the state. Singapore, you know, it got rid of corruption, but it also invested in basic hospitals, good education. It paid its civil servants well. You cannot become a rapidly industrializing country without a government that works. And that is one of the problems that India has to overcome, that in a sense the state is, you know, good in patches, but often doesn't work as well as it should. And that is where I'd look to operate.
The line used to be, India grows at night while the government is asleep.
Hello.
Last question to you,
yeah,
sir.
Good evening. The much talked wedding of Ambani's has two takeaways rather, okay? The first one was, for the first time, the entire Bollywood Bashas and Divas were behind the lead, okay? Her sure. daughter, the first time, they were the side dances rather. The second report says that he spent only minuscule percentage of the money which he has, unlike middle class, which we take loans and keep clearing into the debt, okay? But that is the reality. They will keep ruling. Do you find any alternative for this in another 20, 30 years? They will keep ruling the world. Rather, India at least.
All right.
Do you find any alternate, or rather, we'll keep bashing them every time?
All right.
It is a story of, see, 70 years from Kabutar Khan of Dhirubhai Ambani's to the present era. They exploited World War II or whatever it is.
Should we be celebrating the Ambani wedding and the fact that you could get all of Bollywood, the entire Indian corporate world, most of its political world right there? and celebrate Indian entrepreneurs, or should we be bashing them? And if I could, because this is the last question we have time for, get you to also talk about the wedding you didn't go to.
Yeah, so this was one of my great regrets. So Gautam Adani, when his son was to be married, sent me an invite to his wedding, and I didn't know him or his son or the bride or their parents, and so I thought, well, this must be a mistake. They couldn't possibly have invited me. So I turned them down and turned down an all-expenses weekend paid in Goa, to my great regret, which showed I wasn't a very good journalist. I mean, a bit of billionaire bashing, is there's no harm in that. I think it's interesting to look again, let's go back to the United States and the way that people have changed their perception of the tycoons who made America great in the Gilded Age, who when they were around and alive were viewed conspicuously as villains. So they were seen to be completely unscrupulous, in it for themselves, totally uncaring. And that was why so many of them transformed themselves late in life into great philanthropists, because they were trying to desperately rescue the reputations that they had trashed for themselves. Now we're much more likely to see these people in a more balanced ways as, in a sense, radical figures in a tradition of capitalism's innovators, people who overcame barriers, who built new business models, who did things differently. And I think it's a balance between the two. As I say, I have no problem at all with entrepreneurs who make lots of money. I do have a problem with those who either don't make it honestly or who do not take some of the money that they have made and act responsibly with it. So I don't have a problem with a bit of billionaire bashing as long as it's only to a moderate degree. So.
All right, a round of applause for our speaker. Thanks so much, James. That was fun.